Section 17 of Magna Carta Commemoration Essays. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Marianne. Financial Records of the Reign of King John by Hilary Jenkinson, Part 3. In this connection, we may examine in some detail the first of the two memoranda rolls already noted, though it is to be remarked that neither in this case nor in that of many other records mentioned in this paper can anything approaching exhaustive treatment be attempted. Indeed, the present roll bristles with points of administrative interest which we cannot even notice here. This roll bears on its first membrane the title Communia Memoranda de Termino Sanctus Michaelis Post Mortem Regis Ricardi Anno Regni Regis Johannes Primo. It consists of 16 membranes, all of much the same breadth, about 6 inches, with 6 small pieces of parchment considerably narrower. Membrane 2 is entitled Item Communia Membrana Mich, and membranes 3, 4, Dorsae, 5, Dorsae, and 6 are similarly described. Of these, membrane 1 has the subtitle Isti sunt vice comites, quae venerunt ad sicarium in cross tino Sancti Michaelis vi prose miserunt anno regni Johannes Primo. Membrane 5, D, which is continued by membrane 6, has the subtitle De singulis vice comitibus quae ponunt plura debita super singulos. The meaning of this is made clearer by the form adopted on the next membrane. De vice comitibus quae ponunt debita unus qs quae super alterum, to which a frivolous scribe has added what is possibly the earliest known official jest. The remaining membranes are all of the same kind, each containing matters grouped together under counties. Thus, membrane 4 deals with Surrey and Kent, membrane 5 gives us the affairs of Nottingham and Derby, membrane 9D, those of Oxford, which are continued on membrane 10, and so forth. Membrane 13 is devoted to Jewish business. The small membranes may be left for the moment. It is clear that we have here rolls similar to the later series of memoranda rolls. The arrangement makes this plain, giving us, as it does, adventus vice comitum on the first membrane, and so considerable an amount of the well-known later division of communia. It is fairly clear also that we have not here the first of the series. It is not sufficiently experimental, and indeed there are definite references to earlier memoranda. But to consider the communia in a rather more detail. A large number of the entries under this heading consist of dies date, days assigned to accountants for their auditing, or respites or adjournments. There are about 60 such entries, and roughly speaking, they follow a chronological sequence, though to make this nearly perfect, we must suppose that membrane 4D should properly follow membrane 2. Thus, starting with adjournments, which are mostly for October or November, we work down to those for April. Interspersed with these entries, we have about a dozen cases where it is definitely mentioned that so-and-so venit hic, or venit coram baronibus, on a particular day. These again are chronological, extending from October to the end of March. We have thus in the communia a record which is being compiled day by day during the Michaelmas term, but the entries in which never refer to any auditing which was actually in hand at the moment of writing. This, however, does not end the contents of the communia. Interspersed in this regular chronological sequence are a large number of entries recording that a fine has been made or is due or has been paid, that the king sent his writ in these words, that so-and-so is not to be summoned on such-and-such an account, that a writ has been sent to the sheriff, that an account is to be transferred from one membrane to another on the pipe roll, and so forth. It is to be noted that all communia entries have their counties noted in the margin. Now this last section of entries is not very different in character from those which appear on the other membranes, those arranged under counties. Though these latter tend to be distinguished by the use of such phrases as loquendum cum, to introduce them, and in a number of cases have notes obviously added to them at a later date. Membrane 8 actually has a space deliberately left for such notes. On the whole, I think there can be little doubt that, while the communia include, 1, what are later separate sections in the shape of dies date and various brevia, 2, matters noted for reference when some account, not yet auditing, shall come up or in future terms. The county membranes give us matters left unsettled during the auditing of each sheriff's accounts. This close connection of the county membranes with the actual making of the pipe roll is supported by the fact that their entries are found to correspond with cases on the pipe roll, where the essential words of the entry, the debit or redit compotium, are left blank. If this explanation be correct, we have established that the use of the memoranda in John's time, not only for the noting of calendar arrangements made with the accounts, but also, 1, for recording all kinds of current business, which was now too voluminous to be dealt with without some kind of minutes, 2, the easing of the calls of auditing upon a limited amount of time by the regular reservation of matters which were doubtful or perhaps controversial. This second difficulty, that of time, was met later almost entirely by the expedient of preliminary audit, of which we noticed traces above. We have not quite exhausted the contents of our first memoranda roll. There remain the small membranes and the Jewish membrane. The small membranes include one which again foreshadows a well-known division of the later memoranda roll, giving us amercements of sheriffs who had failed to attend at Easter and appointments of days for views of accounts. This last is obviously important with regard to the matter of shortening the taking of accounts already referred to, but we have not sufficient details to found suggestions upon it. The remainder of the small membranes are a memoranda giving the details of larger sums for which various persons have to account. In a word, they are in the nature of estreats, or of particulars, of which we shall have to say a little later. The Jewish membrane is headed Compotus benedicti de talamant de debitus et finibus iederorum Anglii effesto purificationis anni noni regis Ricardi usque ad festum sancti Hilarii anno Johannes primo. It is to be noted that this is not the actual compotus of Benedict, but memoranda upon it. It is particularly interesting from many points of view, but the whole question of the administration of monies paid by the Jews is so complicated that it is difficult to deal with any sections of it without a reasonable space. We may note, however, that the payments for which this Jew was responsible were apparently not intended to appear, and they did not appear, upon the pipe roll, while on the other hand he apparently did account for them. I have endeavored elsewhere to show that later, at any rate, there was a distinction between receipts from Jewish talliages and receipts from other Jewish sources, the latter, not the former, being collected by the sheriffs and figuring, though obscurely, in their pipe roll accounts and in the ordinary memoranda rolls, whereas talliage matters did not appear on the pipe rolls and, if they required memoranda, must have had special ones devoted to them. Since the matters here noted are of a very general character and are not yet stated to be subject of a compotus, we may conjecture that we have here traces of an early experimental stage in the exchequer treatment of Jewish administration. To sum up, we have here in this memoranda roll not only interesting foreshadowings of the memoranda rolls we know later, and indications of earlier ones in the same series now lost, we have also certain definite signs of the result upon exchequer administration of the increased size and number of accounts. First, the memoranda of the Dialogus developed into Communia, in which were set out in an orderly fashion the various notanda of a busy department, these Communia throwing off, as it were, smaller specialized divisions for certain regularly recurrent items, produced the memoranda roll as we know that record, and in the example we have been examining may be found in embryo all the varieties of matter which the subsequent rolls contain. Secondly, our roll shows us attempts being made to meet the second great difficulty of the period, not only the increased business but the consequent increased demand upon available time. In our roll it is met by the reservation of special points. Later it was met by a system of preliminary audits, the adoption of which eliminates the necessity for country membranes which consequently disappear from the later memoranda rolls. It is even possible that we have in our roll an indication of the trying of this method of separate audit also in the case of the Jewish matters. Finally, the memoranda roll of John's first year gives interesting testimony to the fact that all exchequer development turned on the necessities of the pipe roll and its scribes. Elsewhere I've suggested that even the early receipt rolls, though the Dialogus tells us they were made in the lower exchequer, presumably for the convenience of that office, were conditioned in all the particulars of their form and making by the necessities of the piperal scribe. The same might be said of the country membranes of the memoranda, which we have been discussing. Their arrangement, writing, and form all confirm the inference which may be made from their contents. And in the small membranes which we have noticed, what have we but those rolls or notes of particulars, the existence of which elsewhere is not infrequently noted by the piperal scribe when he has not time or patience to insert their details in his roll? These are the germs of the collection of vouchers by the King's Remembrancer, which has given us our modern class of exchequer accounts, etc. We have dealt at so much length with this important record that there is little space left to discuss others like or connected with it. We may take these in conjunction with the vouchers. It will be remembered that we have to deal with three documents from the class of exchequer accounts and one from the K.R. Miscellanea. To these we may add the companion roll to that just described, LTR Miscellaneous Rolls 1/4, but we may eliminate the Miscellanea document, reserving it for treatment with the Chancery Fine Rolls. Taking first the last of these, a roll of about a dozen membranes, with a few smaller membranes or slips, we find we have to notice most of the features which were prominent in the previous example. We have the title Memoranda, with two interesting variants, which suggest a still fluid state. Memorialia and De Memoriis on membrane 8, and we have apparently Communia on membrane 1. We have Adventus Vicae Comitum, under that title, on membrane 2. We have the same distinction between Communia entries and membranes assigned to particular counties. We have Letters from the King to the Barons, M3, and we have again a special section devoted to the Jews, M13, entitled Compotus, though it is really only a number of memoranda upon an account. In this connection we have to note an innovation, for a similar heading on membrane 12, relating to Hugh de Neville, introduces us to actual rough compotus, which seems to take us a step toward the use of preliminary audit. This roll covers the Easter and Michaelmas terms of the 10th year of John, with some reference to the preceding year. The whole appears to be an incomplete set of membranes. Two final points to be mentioned are concerned with the use of the word extracta as a title on a membrane, M14, containing lists of debts, and with the nature of the small membranes which are here, as before, to be classed as either estreats or particulars. In connection with this last point, it is to be noted that even in the later periods, it is very frequently impossible to decide whether an isolated list of entries in the great form De Jona de London V.S. is an estreat from other records showing amounts which are due, or a particular giving the details of sums actually handled elsewhere on the pipe roll, but handled there only in gross. The presence, of course, of the word extracta makes it certain that we are dealing with a list of debts which are to be extracted, but other of these lists, notably the small membranes on the memoranda, are more probably particulars. This may serve to introduce us to a group of rough rolls giving, under a county arrangement, lists of debts which we may conjecture to have been left over at the end of a term of audit and listed for the purpose of a summons for the next sacrarium. Indeed, we have, in one or two places, items cancelled with the note ponitur in submonicione, or in rotulo est. This group includes, besides membrane 14 of the roll just dealt with, three documents of the next reign, which we may perhaps mention in passing because they correspond so exactly with seven membranes and a fragment out of the 22 which make up Exchequer Accounts 505, number 4, a roll in a very bad condition, which is ascribed to our period and may belong to it, though the evidence for this date is not on any of these eight membranes. It is to be noticed that certain membranes are indexed with a county reference at the foot and have added the word M, presumably for emendator, or some other part of that verb, meaning, apparently, that the list has to be checked. We are left with the bulk of the roll last mentioned, Exchequer Account 505/4, and with Exchequer Accounts 152, number 1, still to be described. Both are of considerable importance, for they are memoranda of the Norman Exchequer. The first, a collection of 13 membranes and a fragment, was joined by accident to the English membranes already noticed, as we may conjecture, during a search for information about forests, conducted, as it appears by an endorsement, a century or so later. However that may be, they are worthy of more study than we have space to give them here. It must suffice to note summarily a few points. Thus, they belong apparently to the year 1201 or 1202. Some of them are similar, mutatis mutandis, to the English rolls of debts just mentioned, and have references to the Norman pipe roll and audit summonses. We may note in connection with some of these that the use of the words extracta memorandarum, the last supporting the suggestion made above, in connection with the use of extracta in the English memoranda, that these lists were made up at the close of a session of the Exchequer from the memoranda of the term. On another membrane, we have memoranda precisely similar to those in the English communia of terms given for rendering account, and notes beginning saliendum or debet respondere, all annotated in the margin with the names of the districts to which they refer. But perhaps most remarkable are two membranes dealing with impress, receipts in money and kind, by Warren de Glapion and others, and expenditure at Rouen and other places over a period named, and mentioning the receipt, at the Norman Exchequer, of a rotulus de camera regis. The significance of all this information is obscure, but it clearly indicates proceedings both complicated and varied, showing at the same time a close connection with the English court and distinct individuality at the Norman Exchequer. The other Norman document of a memoranda character is a single membrane having no date. Monsieur Le Gras puts it early in the reign of John. In several places it is entitled Extractus Memorandarum. Also it has a note, amend, and another, ponitur in rotulo. All points connecting this with the documents we have been noticing. It has, however, two characteristics of its own. One is a vertical line drawn through the part to which the note ponitur appears to relate, a familiar device in later exchequer procedure. The other is the fact that we have here apparently not so much memoranda for the use of the court as instructions to an official who was to collect the debts. Dati ipso is a frequent entry, and it appears that this official, whoever he was personally responsible for a large number of accounts. With this we must leave the question of memoranda and vouchers, of the two exchequers, noting only in passing an indenture which may be presumed to have been a voucher to some kind of count. This last very interesting document, which I believe has not been printed, gives particulars of the contents and disposal of prizes brought into Portsmouth by John's galleys from 25 April to 8 September in his 13th year. This completes, so far as present space and knowledge allow it, our survey of the Upper Exchequer. We turn to the Lower Exchequer, which may be quickly dealt with. Of original receipts, as we have noticed, there is possibly one. The person whose debt is mentioned on this tally, Jordan Nepos Geruasii, appears in records from the end of the reign of Henry II to that of John. Possibly the writing on the tally makes the later date more probable. Of receipt rolls, we have practically nothing. The very interesting roll of the reign of Henry II, with a similar one of the reign of Richard I, which has lately come to light, suggests that the receipt roll was in origin closely connected with the processes of the Upper Exchequer. The handwriting, though smaller, is similar, so is the division, into counties. The reign of John furnishes us with an important roll showing the development out of this state, as the present writer interprets it, into that which we find in the early years of Henry III. The John roll, which is devoted to receipts from Jews, was prepared in and for the Exchequer of Receipt. In this roll we find the parchment enlarged, and the writing made smaller than in the previous examples, so that there is space for two or three columns abreast, though the pipe roll habit of noting the contents at the foot of the membrane still persists. It is this type of roll, with its fuller contents, its summae added at intervals, a matter which would not concern the pipe roll scribe, and its makeup, in many cases, with membranes of issues, which seem first to show us the idea of a receipt roll applied to the convenience of its makers rather than that of the pipe roll scribes. Before leaving this subject, we must mention a small roll, which has always been classed, in modern times at least, with the receipt rolls, though in character it resembles rather the particulars mentioned above, and though it came to the Record Office from the Tower of London. It will be convenient, however, to reserve it for illustration of a later point. Turning to issues, we have again to note the preservation of only one original, a writ of liberate, now among the ancient correspondence. It is interesting because there are only two earlier ones known, that printed by Dr. Round and that given by Madox. Like Dr. Round's specimen, it is sent by the Chancellor, presumably in the King's absence. Of enrollments of writs we have no example. The earliest is attached to the earliest complete general receipt roll belonging to the fourth year of Henry III. The earliest example of the later form of roll, which gives only a summary of the writ, belongs to the 25th year of Henry VI. Leaving for the time the question of the records of financial departments other than the Exchequer, we pass to the records which, though belonging to the Chancery, affect either directly or indirectly the Exchequer processes. The first question that faces us is that of the connection between the collections of the two countries, together with the possibility already referred to that the Norman set are not homogeneous and perhaps not all Chancery rolls. As to the nature and number of the Norman rolls, as that name was understood in the past, we have little to guide us. We have notice of the bringing of rolls from Normandy, but this does not help us. Nor can the conclusions which Hardy based upon an indenture of the time of Richard II be relied upon in this particular. In point of fact, one of the surviving rolls is definitely of Norman Exchequer origin. It begins, Hic est rotulus catarum et chirographorum Normannorum factus tempore, Guarini de Glepon Senescali Normanni, assistenibus ad Scacerium Sansone Abate Cadomi. This is a roll of fines made at the Norman Exchequer and of private deeds, including some charters from Henry II and Richard and a number from John, enrolled, we may presume, for safety among the records of the King's Court, a function of the Norman Exchequer of which we have little notice elsewhere. On the other hand, Norman Roll No. 1, which has been added to the series since Hardy's time, is merely the first part, for the month of April, of the first English Liberate Roll, while No. 7, which was printed by Hardy, is a roll of the values of the lands of Normans in England after John had lost the duchy. Of the remaining four rolls, No. 2, to John, entitled De Oblatus Receptus, corresponds closely with the English fine rolls, but relates to Norman affairs. The Et Mandatum Est, when it appears, is addressed to Norman officials, and there are interesting references to summonses to the Norman Exchequer. Roll 4, belonging to the same year, is called Rotulus de Contribuibus. The meaning of this is explained below. For the moment, we need only observe that the writs are generally addressed to Norman officials or else to persons abroad, while on the other hand, the dates of the last membrane of the roll suggest that it was made in England. Number 5, for John, is a Rotulus Terrarum Liberatarum et Contribuium, the dating of which writs enrolled here, save at the beginning, is abroad, and itself was presumably made abroad. The references, too, are clearly to Norman administration. We have a special note of a matter, quod debet scribi in rotulo Angli. Number 6, 5 John, is a similar roll to number 5, and it is to be noticed that a fragmentary fifth membrane, added in 1838, has never been printed. The addresses of writs on this roll are generally Norman, and the dates all Norman, save four at the end, corresponding to John's return from Normandy to England in this year. It seems clear that these two English-dated writs are only included on the roll by mistake. A mistake in the other direction has a special note, in rotuo Anglii totum bruei. Now from a later experience of the Glasgow rolls and other special chancery enrollments, we may remark that a special roll of this kind may either be 1. A roll of letters dated abroad, or 2. A roll of letters referring to foreign matters, whether these appear in other, ordinary enrollments or not. What is the principle on which the Norman rolls were made? There is no serious doubt that at this date the Chancery still, as a rule, followed the King. There is a prima facie case, therefore, for making the Norman roll a roll written in Normandy. I think this conclusion is made almost certain by the ending, already noticed, of Norman Roll 4. On the other hand, the personal touch of the King being still strong in affairs, it is not unreasonable to suppose that Norman affairs would rather monopolize the attention of his Chancery when he was in Normandy and English ones when he was in England, provided, of course, that he was in any given year dividing up his time pretty fairly between the two countries. This probably resulted sometimes, by confusion, in a belief that Norman entries should go on the Norman roll, resulted, that is, in the interpretation of this roll's function upon a subject basis, so that we get contemporaneous rolls of English and Norman liberate, find upon an English liberate roll Norman entries cancelled, quia in roto Normani, and have, as has been seen, one Norman roll actually compiled in England. The confusion would go so far that the Norman-made rolls, composed, as we shall see, entirely of entries having a financial interest, would be preserved in Normandy in the interests of the Norman exchequer, although, unlike the exchequer rolls, they did not owe their existence to a separate body of scribes. This would explain the presence in the modern series of the Norman exchequer roll noticed above. End of section 17.